Thank you all for hanging around. My name is Rick Howe. I am a business consultant in the States. As I like to say, I'm 30 minutes from Comcast and an hour from NBC. I also write a column under the name The ITV Doctor, which has nothing to do with your network here in London. It is interactive television. That's how I started doing that. Today we're going to be talking about over-the-top television, and we're going to ask each of these fine gentlemen, including the latecomer, to introduce themselves, and we're actually going to jump one step ahead, talk about yourself briefly, but let's get started right away. Give us a succinct summary of your company's strategy in over-the-top, okay? Starting here.
Whoa. I get the first one, huh? All right, hi, I'm Dave Mowry. I head up product management for ClearLeap. We are a cloud-based TV Everywhere over-the-top services platform servicing the largest companies in pay TV and content owners. I think what's really interesting about the platform or the panel that we have today is we're talking about how the strategies and viewer expectations are changing, but I think you know that has a large effect on the businesses of some of the gentlemen up here and our customers around the world. What's happening is the as viewer expectations are shifting, your technology needs are really changing as well. And what we've seen is a lot of companies have stood up kind of a version one of TV Everywhere over-the-top services. And as the expectations of their viewers have matured and their business models have matured, they're really looking to formalize that strategy and the technology strategy that goes along with it. So I think this panel is interesting to look at both from the viewer expectation perspective, but also from the technology perspective as well.
Thank you very much. Let's go.
So hello, I'm Nick Coulter. I head up digital business for BBC Worldwide. For those who don't know, BBC Worldwide is the commercial subsidiary owned by BBC, the public service broadcaster in the UK. And our role, and my role in particular, is to look after sales of TV programs to digital platforms, to develop the strategy around the non-linear rights and the on-demand content, and how we get to market and how we get to the consumer. Summing up our OTT strategy succinctly is a challenge. We have a variety of approaches because we distribute TV sale, we distribute build programs, we're the largest distributor of TV programs outside the US studios. And so we sell to platforms that aggregate content, OTT platforms that aggregate content. We also operate a channels business. We, in the UK, the iPlayer is a public service OTT platform. And you may or may not have heard that BBC intend to launch a product called BBC Store, which is a commercial addition to the iPlayer in the UK. We have had a product called Global iPlayer outside of the UK, which was a trial SVOD service. Only available to date on iOS, so we've been active. We have a lot of plans about what's coming next, but succinctly is probably beyond me.
Alberto.
Yeah, my name is Alberto Rull. I come from Spain. I represent probably the only linear television here, and one of the old ones. We are starting our strategy for all the OTT services. We have nothing in place already. We're in beta testing, so but we're defining our strategy, and I think we have found a different approach to it as we are a small station, regional station of the area of Madrid, and our key advantage is proximity with our viewers and consumers. As any linear television, we've lost the battle for youngest audience. And the youth, we are very much old skewed in the target audience. So we decided to go for a strategy which integrates the user-generated content within our OTT services. I know it may sound strange, but we are poor, we don't have much money to invest, so we decided that there is a way to create a real value on user-generated content integrating it into professional workflow. Thanks.
Morali?
Sure. Hi, my name is Morali Nimani, and I'm with Active Video. We're a small Silicon Valley company that fundamentally our premise is that you want to virtualize as many of the set-top box functions in the cloud, decoupling the services and the applications that run in the cloud from the device dependencies. And the idea is that if you decouple that relationship, you essentially speed up innovation and the rollout of services to a ubiquitous footprint of your devices, whether it's the existing devices or your new devices. So some of the interesting applications of that is obviously, you know, as operators are trying to roll out next generation EPG guide navigation paradigms, how do you deliver that across your entire footprint and not just limited to your new set of devices that are slow to roll out or very capital intensive to roll out? This is where the power of the cloud really makes a difference, because you're abstracting the rendering of that application, pushing it into the cloud, and overcoming the dependencies on the devices. The second one that's really interesting is some of the work that we're doing with the OTT vendors and the OTT guys like YouTube and Hulu and others that we're working with, to essentially, our premise is that pay TV, the evolution of pay TV, should be the integrated marriage of the best in linear content with extended long tail libraries coming from the web. And so if you can bring those two together and use the power of the cloud to integrate that and render that from the cloud and deliver it to your entire footprint of devices, then you have a breakthrough service. And so that's what we do.
Very good. Luke?
Hi there. My name's Luke Gayden. I'm from Brightcove. We're entering our second decade of helping media organizations like the BBC Worldwide and ITV distribute and monetize online video. We're a cloud content services company. And I think when it comes to OTT, we see our job as helping media organizations address the ever-increasing complexities of OTT delivery and monetization. I think one of the most interesting aspects of the road ahead for OTT is still the amount of value in terms of whether that's ad dollars or increased audience share that is still locked up within that landscape. So our strategy, as I said, is to really help our customers unlock that value.
Thank you. Neil?
Hi, I'm Neil Dennett, Director of Paid Content at ITV. So I recognize a lot of what Nick was saying earlier in terms of BBC. Our focus is in distributing our channels and our content. We do that through third parties, but also we have a fairly mature OTT strategy and suite of services through ITV Player in the UK with over 10 million registered users. So we've got quite a lot of experience in this space, but our strategy going forward is really about optimizing that. So it's enhancing the user experience, consumer experience, in terms of better content, better windows, better access to content, making sure the experience of viewing that content is as good as it can be, getting rid of the buffering, getting rid of all those things that get in the way of watching good TV, and optimizing the monetization of that content, looking at new business models. We're ad-supported at the moment, looking at new ways of ad replacement, ad insertion, and other business models to try and unlock additional value from that content and make it available to users in a way they wish to consume it and pay for it.
Thank you. And Jin-Shan.
Hi, my name is Jin-Shan. I'm head of a Bus R&D Institute from ZTE Corporation. So we are the technology provider for pay TV operators. We've been seeing a strong need for market to allow the end users to watch TV in a much, much better, more flexible way with, on any device and at any place. And our strategy is to help our customers, meaning pay TV operators, to make that happen, make that transition as smooth as possible, and more importantly, to monetize their content. Thank you.
Okay, now listen. we know that in the business of television, we have a tendency to sell what we've got, first and foremost, and secondarily, we focus on selling what the consumer wants. How are each of you going to deal with a space of going direct to consumer now, as opposed to going through a distributor, and now all of a sudden you have data on what the consumer is actually using and you own that data? How does that change your business? Let's go over to Nick. We'll start at BBC. How does it change your business when you are actually the delivery agent for your content right into a consumer's home?
Well, it makes it more complicated. There's a lot of tax issues we didn't think of. But it changes it in a lot of ways. So we don't entirely sell what we've got and think about the consumer afterwards anyway. I think, you know, the way we sell content, we try to start from consumer insight, target the person we're going to sell it to or the platform, the distributor, and sort of go that way anyway. So we've got a fair amount of insight about what consumers think of our content and how they consume it. In terms of the information we're getting direct from our own services, it's a lot of data to analyze. So there's iPlayer in the UK is worldwide. We don't really have access to that data. It's not part of our relationship. We don't have privileged access to it. But we do have access to what we've learned from Global iPlayer, which we launched a couple of years back around the world. And we've learned an awful lot from that about how to curate content and, you know, the lifetime of content and what works and what doesn't. I think it's very interesting that, you know, the current trends, the way we're selling content to other aggregators, is really strongly, powerfully driven by what's the very newest returning series with a strong narrative arc. That's kind of it, and that's what virtually every production company in the world is focusing on now, and that's driven by one or two platforms, Netflix and Amazon. So it's quite interesting that the data we get back from third parties is sort of terms and conditions within our contracts, which tell us which of our content is performing the best in that environment, which is that kind of content, Orphan Black, Doctor Who, Sherlock, is not necessarily the same learnings we get from running our own service. And that is far more about, well, we've got a catalogue of 50,000 hours of content. We need to surface some of that. And if we do surface some of it, and if there's a new David Attenborough special, we can surface some of his old series as well. And that works. So it's quite interesting. As a single publisher distributor of content running an OTT platform, there are very different lessons, I think, to what works compared to when you're selling content to someone like Netflix.
At ITV, if you were waiting for Sky to give you information about people watching your content, how long would you have to wait?
In terms of who's watching content?
And yeah, how long you're staying on, abandonment rates, what they watch afterwards, audience flow, all those lovely things.
That's challenging, but actually those platforms are increasingly starting to offer that data and availability of that data to content providers. So it's not too far off where we'll be able to access that, what we think, which will be very helpful from a... I mean, there's two types of data here, isn't there? There's the consumption usage data, there's data of how content performs, and then there's data of who's watching it, and the different types of data used for different purposes, with that content or product enhancing data or data that can enhance the monetization of that data. But both those types of data are increasingly being made available either directly for our own over-the-top services, but increasingly through third-party platforms.
Now, I would assume the guys at Brightcove can give you the data on what people are watching second by second, tonight, platform by platform, and whether I started watching something on TV and then went over and finished on my tablet, right?
Yeah, that's correct. So part of the value that services like Brightcove bring is the sort of richness of the analytics that we can provide back to our customers, which help them create, you know, better, more engaging user experiences, and also allow them to kind of more intelligently program their content. You know, the other, and I think, you know, more interesting use of analytics where there's a huge amount of potential, I think still has to be unlocked, is in the sort of promise of more targeted, more engaging, and just overall a better advertising experience, which certainly from an analytics, from a data perspective, is something that we're very focused on, as I'm sure as everybody here.
Now, clearly, if you do something similar, right, you provide that kind of information, are you able to provide guidance so that someone who's programming a network or selecting from their catalog can actually change the mix on the fly?
Yes. Yeah, and I think that's an important point, is being able to change the programming on the fly. There's also, you talked a little bit about the content analytics, but there's also the user analytics that go along with that. Being able to plug how a user is consuming the service across the devices, along with how they're subscribing, and in the case of a SVOD service instead of an AVOD service, how is that user interacting with being a billed customer? So you know, what content are they watching before, right before they churn out of the service? What about upgrading to the next tier of service? How many views do they have to have on what devices? Will they, you know, will it take to retain that user? So building in the subscriber analytics along with the consumption analytics on the device side is really, really important for certain business models. But I think that's the key here is that there are so many different variations of a service, whether it's different business models, different regions, different device matrix. There's a lot of complexity that goes into creating this original OTT strategy that we're talking about. That's why it's it's so complex for you to come up with the model. I wanted to ask these guys, sorry, not to take your place here, Rick, but how are the content providers thinking about in which markets, in which environments are you thinking about SVOD versus AVOD versus TVOD and all the other VODs? Sorry, Rick.
I'll begin. it's a good question, and it's at the core of what we're looking at now. So we announced last year that we're launching to a new group of brands, BBC Brit, BBC Earth, BBC First. And the point of those brands was to sort of think, well, what's the BBC really good at? And can stand alongside anybody, wants a British drama, that's BBC First. There's BBC Brit, which is about factual entertainment and comedy, and BBC Earth, which is about science and natural history. So we've created brands around that. Now, we've launched a couple of channels the other week in the Nordics, and Poland, Britain Earth launched as well. But they're not going to be channels everywhere, and in some ways it's a funny time to be going further into the channels business.
Right.
We've been in it for 10 years, but to be launching new channels now is an odd thing to do. But the reason for that is because we think these are umbrella brands that have value, and there wouldn't necessarily be a channel in every space. So to your point, there will be markets in which there will be SVOD. There may be markets in which an AVOD play will be the correct one to do. Maybe somewhere where there isn't a big penetration of pay TV and there's not a lot of money. And in other places, we'll do SVOD directly. In other places, we'll still remain a TV sales-led market and not do OTT at all. But those brands are placeholders for a sort of a BBC-curated experience in lots of different ways of playing out. And I think TVOD is another good example, just very briefly, and sorry for hogging the mic, because I think there are lots of ways of engaging with fans, and there are a number of platforms which can take that sort of EST or TVOD relationship directly to where the fans are, and it's quite an interesting space to explore. So we recently did a trial with BitTorrent and Doctor Who as a, essentially as a fan engagement proposition. So there are lots of different ways of letting those brands play out. And to answer your question, we take it market by market, and it's quite complicated.
Right.
Alberto, at Telemadrid now, you are just looking at where to go, if to go over the top. How are you making that decision of what do you do next?
Yeah, I mean, mainly because we felt that we've been apart. I mean, we're outside of the play, and we are a public station, so we need to keep relevant for our viewers and the Madrid citizens, and that's how we started this new initiative, because we need to keep relevant to them and how we can give something to them back. I mean, it's also a business model, but we thought, okay, we have some major stuff. I mean, we have made deals with major companies about film, series, and all that stuff. I mean, this is another business for us. I mean, it's not for us to be a player on this type of content. We cannot do nothing with that. I mean, we're small. We don't have the capability of making big investments. So we have our catch-up service on video on demand. So we thought how we should be into the game, and as I said before, we needed to be relevant to the younger generations, and that's why we want to be there, actually.
All right, now if you were in a situation before Over the Top and you wanted to get a channel out there, we all know that the business was you go to the service provider, you beg, you borrow, you give them anything they need to get a channel. You no longer need that. Jinshan, how cheaply can you help him launch an over-the-top channel?
Yes, I think our mission or our goal is really to use the technology we have today to help the content providers to reach their audience as much as possible based on a really lightweight, flexible technology in the market. As you said, I think today's users or the audience, they are looking at different screens. And our technology is helping these content providers to reach those devices, audiences, different social platforms as much as possible. That's I think, what we trying to do as for our clients today.
Right, thank you. Now, Marani at Active Video, you guys have been in the business for a long time. You began business serving the needs of the service providers. Yeah. As I understand from listening to you speak earlier, you're now taking the technology that you originally recommended for service providers,
yeah,
and you're applying that in an over-the-top environment. But what's interesting is you are straddling both worlds now.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
As a technology provider to content providers and service providers,
yeah,
can a traditional service provider coexist? Can he operate even an over-the-top platform? Can he be in two places at once?
Yeah, I mean,
can Charter?
Exactly. So we always believe that the value of the pay TV bundle, if you think about the aggregated channel lineup, was always very appealing to the consumer. The problem is the content library has just exponentially grown. Infinite content libraries from your folks. We were listening to someone saying that CBS only uses 2% of their library. If that's true, then 98% is sitting idle, right? So the issue is, how do you create value into the pay TV bundle, right? And in that context, I think our technology has sort of paved the road for companies like UPC in Hungary to integrate YouTube as a channel within their pay TV lineup. So if you think about, you know, some of the work we're doing with some of the OTT providers, it's really to say, okay, you want to get your application onto as many set-tops as possible, because that's still the primary means of watching television, is the television screen. So whether you're a Hulu, whether you're a Netflix, whether you're a YouTube or an HBO Go, you're still trying to get onto the main screen, because that's where a lot of the on-demand libraries can be served up to better facilitate. The issue is bridging that divide has been really hard, because the television technology is different from the online streaming technology, and the devices that the television guys have deployed can't support browsers or can't support the right DRM technologies and so forth. So a lot of the things that we've done is essentially deploy YouTube, for example, as a channel within your guide itself. So YouTube becomes channel 201, Hulu becomes 202. Netflix becomes 203. It's not an app. It's not an app store. It's just another linear type of a channel that you call up. And when you hit that channel on your guide, it brings up Netflix's entire user interface, and you browse Netflix as just as you are any other device. So that's an example of how we've sort of brought value back to the pay TV operator, but we've given eyeballs to the YouTubes and the Netflixes that otherwise they were having difficulty reaching.
Bright Cove, can the consumer find all that stuff?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So I think that there's been a recognition on the part of a lot of operators, broadcasters, and media organizations who are launching these services that increasingly, content discovery, navigation, recommendations, all of these kind of aspects of the user journey is becoming increasingly important. There are an ever-increasing number of services with an ever-increasing content library, yep, as Murali made out. And so, it's that age-old question of, if there's infinite choice, how do you decide what you're going to watch? I think the winners are going to be the people who are able to knit together the content library that they have at their disposal with really, really engaging user experiences that kind of take data, take analytics, and create a really, really top-notch discovery, recommendations, and kind of navigation experience. But a lot of this is going to be about how good that user experience is to help the people find that content.
Neil, who designs that user experience, you or ClearLeap?
probably a combination of and a collaboration of parties. We have a good understanding of the content catalogue, the content, our audience, but we absolutely recognise that those third parties can come and bring in insights that can enhance that.
Clearly, do you have the data you need to do this job?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, to Neil's point, I would answer that as, you know, Neil designs the interface. At least that's the way we see it. We can provide the insights and the content differentiation within the catalog to help design the interface. We have a lot of learnings throughout years of doing this to help out. But our customers, and I think, you know, the trends are really moving towards the brands really taking full ownership of that consumer experience. That's the way we're seeing it, is that our big customers really want, they want to forget about the technology behind it, but they want to own the brand and the experience. And that's a really important part of where they need to focus on their creating the niche channels that really, you know, differentiate the content and allow their consumers to find the content they're looking at. That's what they need to focus on, monetizing their content.
Okay, here's an open question, and we're going to start getting a little bit creative here. You've all now heard me use my kitchen table analogy that I forecasted a year ago, and it has become true, that the consumer is sitting at her kitchen table, and she has her HBO Now subscription, her CBS subscription, her husband's ESPN subscription, somebody's drama subscription, maybe that cool, real cool EastEnders package from BBC, even the David Hasselhoff channel from NBC. And they're all billed differently. She has different bills, different rates, some on iTunes, some on PayPal. She doesn't have a guide that can control it all. Let's get creative. What do you do to help that consumer? What do each of you do, or who actually does do it, and is there a business there? Open up.
I'll take a step. I think this is one of the reasons why you're starting to see some skinny bundles in the market, particularly in the United States. You know, I think people are recognizing that a full a la carte model is going to be a tremendously difficult consumer experience for users. But I definitely think there's some advantages here. You know, I think Apple launching their service is kind of a game changer from that perspective. There are very few platforms around the world that can really consolidate the user experience and the billing flow in the way that some of the big app aggregators are. But I think from a consumer experience, Rick, consumers are pretty used to having 150 apps on their phone. I don't think they're as intimidated as we all think they are. At least not yet.
They're not paying a monthly subscription for all of those apps that way. I mean,
not every one of them, but more and more of them they are.
Okay. Sure. So you think that because we have trained ourselves to deal with our games programs and this and that and the other thing on my iPhone, that I can handle TV services the same way?
I think it helps, but there's no doubt there's a challenge there for consumers. But I think it's, if there were a bunch of different billing platforms and you had to put in a bunch of different terms of service and you had to put in your credit card 15 times, that's a much different problem than a consolidated billing platform. Just my opinion.
Anybody else?
So there's one other argument. I mean, if you pick up on the skinny bundle type of argument, there's also those who essentially look at and say, look, a lot of content that I'm watching, I still want linear content because I'm, you know, ultimately sports is still the reason why we sign up to these cable packages and pay TV packages, because you can't live without it, right? I mean, it's some member in your family will want it and needs it. But a lot of the favorite content is actually coming from sources outside of an operator's domain. And it may be directly from the content provider themselves. It may be an aggregator that has tremendous amount of clout. But The opportunity is to aggregate those and be able to present it with, you know, this idea of an interface that actually cuts across these variety of different assets for the ease of which you discover and find content. That's one value proposition. The other is to be able to take really rich content sources, as your cable channels and your premium content channels, and be able to say, now I can not just give you the linear or your broadcast sort of equivalent, but now you can actually enable the long tail with, you know, the way CBS Access or with HBO Go that complements HBO, you know, as a subscription-based service on your linear programming. So what you can do is you can actually add the long tail libraries, Food Network, you know, bring the entire library of Food Network, History Channel, Discovery Channel. All these guys have long tail libraries that would be very complementary to the basic premise of watching and tuning into their programming. So this is where content and the value can be created for the consumer, and yet a lot of value retained in the bundle.
Nick, does that make sense for ITV?
Nick O'Neill.
From an ITV perspective, I agree. There's obviously, we would like viewers to have a relationship directly with ITV, and I think big brands like the BBC and ITV in the UK are going to find it easier to justify a place in a world where there's a lot of opportunities to engage with different content providers. I think a few will gravitate towards the top, and there's some big brands that consumers are going to be comfortable with, and that's a good position to be in. I think others, although small niche content propositions, are going to be fighting to get in front of the relevant audiences. I think that's going to be a challenge. I think we already see aggregators starting to materialise here, though. If you look at what some of the mobile operators and platform operators like TalkTalk TV are doing, they're increasingly not wanting to acquire all this content in themselves. They're quite happy to give you an interface for that content and allow you to subscribe to particular bundles within off of one billing system that they can offer. So I think we're going towards that world.
All right, so now listen. It does sound a little bit like the content is the same. The distributors might shift a bit, but some of the major players are going to stay plugged into this. Is over the top a real change in business, or is it just a change in delivery technology?
I think it's a change in business.
Because
the one thing I was sort of starting to get, I'm not sure about all of that, is because I sort of agree with what David was saying, that people probably don't want to have 7 or 8 different subscriptions. I sort of don't really buy that. And, you know, with all the projections about pay TV, it'll continue to grow, but slowly. But IPTV pay TV bundles are growing quickly. And that's because they have the nimbleness that some of these guys are talking about, the ability to reinvent the proposal and the proposition to the consumer without having to install new hardware. And alongside that, you've got people like Netflix, who famously said, we're trying to become HBO before HBO can become Netflix, which is the clearest indicator of all that they regard themselves as basically a network, but of a modern network. And they've recognized the trend and the drift and the downward pressure on revenues for pay TV and the drift towards unbundling. And I think the future environment is more that what's a future channel look like? It looks like you've probably got Netflix sitting alongside HBO, alongside, you know, I hope BBC First, alongside Vice, alongside a whole bunch of other things, probably channels drawn in from YouTube or something that Sam's created on Vimeo that we heard about earlier. That feels more like a way you can bundle together a more curated collection of content, and then the brands like BBC, like HBO, like Netflix, their value is in being good curators of content and known for something. But it's still a kind of a pay TV model, and it might not be all the same incumbents if they're not quick enough, but it is kind of pay TV still, in my mind.
Anybody else?
Yeah, actually, I think it's much more a matter of delivery. Actually, I mean, it's a matter of consumption. How do you consume the content? But, I mean, of course, there's a different business model out of it. But at the end, we're still taking content and delivering it to the user. It's much more accurate. at the same time that the advertisement is much accurate, it's made to you, you're targeted to it. But at the end, we still do the same old thing. If I have this, please watch that and consume it. I mean, everywhere, anywhere, anytime. We agree. It doesn't need a big change, I think. But in the end, it's a matter of delivery at the end. So.
Yeah, I don't entirely disagree. That's why I mean, I think OTT is an evolution of pay TV rather than being a different thing completely.
We had a question from the audience here.
I'd like to know, in this new environment, who's the gatekeeper?
Who is the gatekeeper? Is there, in fact, a gatekeeper?
So the content aggregators, in the sense of whether... So the question is going to be, is your content library, if you're a content producer, is it rich enough to justify demand on its own? Or do you have to work through an aggregator, right? And in which case, is the aggregator the operator or is the aggregator a Netflix, right? So you're going to see this where consumers, I'm not a consumer expert, but I do look at it as, do consumers want 7 different subscriptions that they have to sort of go through each one trying to figure out which content resides? Who has the exclusive rights for Downton Abbey? Oh, that's Amazon. Versus who has the exclusive rights for, Breaking Bad, which is completely different, content company. So now you have to think about it and you have to say, okay, do I know that? Or do I want something aggregated for me so I can find it and have access to it?
Anybody else? Jinchen?
Yes, I just want to add a point that I don't believe that it's going to be the end user need to choose 7 or 8 different CBS Online or the HBO Now. I think we are seeing from the pay TV operator to make more lean of their bundles, make their offer more flexible. So I think we'll see somewhere in between. From a completely flexible ad hoc way of combining offers, completely a la carte, and also between the now classic pay TV model of a fixed bundle. I think we'll see somewhere in between. You're going to see more flexible offer from the pay TV operator, and we're combining, which will be complemented with 1 or 2 personal favorites. OTT offer that is not yet included. So I don't think it's going to be a free world. It's going to still be regulated plus some free options.
We have another question.
Similar question, but different approach. With DOCSIS 3.1, we're not talking about a 1 gigabit connection. And I think this is going to be necessary with the advent of 4K and Super HD 4K. Is there a point where there's so much video consumed over the top that the cost of connectivity will, for some people, be out of reach?
Anybody? Bright Cove, you're waiting.
There was a very interesting article I read recently which suggested that both the cost of connectivity and then the increasing prices that are being paid for certain content rights, like sports is a great example, was going to create, the haves and the have-nots in terms of access to certain types of video content. So far, the increase in video consumption seems to be the increase in technologies to support the increase in video consumption seem to be keeping pace with each other. It's not difficult to imagine a world where that's going to get out of balance. I can see that world happening, sure.
Anybody else? All right, given that I'm hearing announcements about wanting to close us down, we're not quite out of time yet, but I would like to take one shot, and let's say we are back here just 1 year from now. We're going to start on that end. What will change substantially in this business in this next year? Jinchen.
I think we're going to see a flourishing, many offers, OTT offers, maybe coming from a content providers who believe that they could command a certain audience. But I think after this... I wouldn't call it a boom, but I think after this period, we'll come back to the let's say, the previous model of having more flexible bundling. It will be majorly proposed by the pay TV operator, and with a few really strong branding offers like from HBO Now, and I think we'll see that happening in 1 year from now.
Very good. Neil?
Yeah, I agree. I think we're going to see so many new SVOD propositions, particularly launched in the next year. I think we're going to find them all over the place. We're going to be swamped, and we're going to go through a big bubble of trying to work out which ones to sign up to and how and where to find them, etc. I think that's probably a temporary situation, and it will then settle back down into a more realistic position with some consolidation.
Luke, where are we going to be in a year?
So focusing away from the sort of SVOD model, I hope that we'll see an increasing amount of advertising revenue being unlocked from AVOD services. Again, as I said earlier, I still think there's an enormous amount of value and revenue that isn't being realized in that business model. So there's work to be done on sort of shared metrics. There's work to be done on kind of better advertising formats, but that's where I'd like to see us in a year's time.
Raleigh?
Probably more evidence that OTT content doesn't detract from the value of a pay TV service, but complements. And I think what people might actually find is that there's evidence that if OTT services are successfully received by consumers, that you can offset some of the content acquisition cost hikes that operators are bearing and offload some of that to these aggregators that are coming from online.
Alberto?
Yeah, no, I think it would change, I mean, how we perceive the OTT consumption as a consumer. You will see like something natural, which it is not that much now. I mean, we are used to the linear pay TV thing, and I think we will see the market become a bit mature from the consumer perspective, and also for our linear TV and our business model, and also the advertisement and revenue thing, I think, and it is the key point for the industry, actually.
Nick?
I think you'll probably see the first serious pay TV bundles to include genuinely non-linear channels. And I think you'll see the first audience of 100 million live streams for a massively online player game.
Very good. David?
That was a good one.
I agree with everybody. I think you're going to see significant shift to SVOD services this year, creating kind of chaos that we just talked about from the consumer perspective. I don't think it's going to be shaken out into the bundled approach just yet within a year. I think it's going to probably take a little bit longer than that, but you never know. It goes fast around here. And I think I think you will see an increase in the CPM rates on the AVOD services as the consumption continues to shift to the online services. So,
very good. Do we have any questions from the audience? Yes, sir. I'm coming. Couldn't have asked me before. I was sitting right behind you.
With a lot of OTT going through the in the home through the over the mobile Wi-Fi and over the Wi-Fi network, and enabling unicast delivery of advertising, how does the panel see this working alongside, or kind of disrupting the traditional way that advertising is bought and sold, because it can be delivered programmatically?
From an ITV perspective, we're still considering the programmatic, because there's a lot of challenges with programmatic around the data and around delivering that right now. Actually, from our perspective, we see ourselves as the biggest marketing platform in the UK, and we're all about brand building. So actually getting out brands in front of everyone. So particularly on the TV, I think I see less change on the TV. I think for handheld individual devices where you can identify, be it through Wi-Fi or whatever, but you can identify that individual user. And I think some increased targeting of advertising and shifting of money across to that. But I think programmatic's still a bit far away for us just right now.
Anybody else?
Yeah, so I think I think if you accept that a bit of disruption has to happen in order for existing ways of doing business to improve, then I'd like to see that disruption taking place. I absolutely take Neil's point about where programmatic is, certainly in the plans of the likes of ITV and so forth. And I think we're out of time.
Mine's still working.
Well, thank you. I think there is going to be some disruption to the existing model, and I think that's a good thing. Again, as I've said a couple of times, there's still an enormous amount of revenue that is not being realized, and I think that's because we are locked into, or have been locked into, a particular way of doing business around the advertising model, and that does need to change.
We have a question over here on the right.
Except for Nick's comment about online gaming, nobody's even mentioned new forms of content, multi-screen experiences, all that kind of stuff. Isn't that going to radically change the whole OTT space as well?
I think we've been talking about second screen for a few years now, and it doesn't really, I don't think anything's going to change the next year that hasn't really been explored in the last few years in terms of fundamental change. I think there's some evolution, some additional, definitely a lot of incremental activity happening in that respect. I don't see it being a fundamental change.
But I don't mean just multi-screen. I mean, Twitch is bigger than HBO now. Yeah.
But if you look at actually compare that to what we're mostly talking about here, is long-form TV viewing. It's still tiny in terms of actual viewing activity. Short form is something different. It's serving a different need and a different place. And absolutely, that activity will grow. But I don't see it changing too much.
I think short and mid form is pretty. It's becoming pretty substitutional for younger audiences and is the main thing they watch with the odd TV program that they want to talk about. But I think short form and some of the best of YouTube content, that's what certain generations is watching and not a lot else, and gaming as well, and following Machinima and Twitch and all those platforms. So, that is something that is something that in my mind sits alongside current creators. That is our competition as content creators at the moment.
Taking from people's time, spare time, is not necessarily taking from TV, arguably. Were those people actually, that audience, was it actually watching TV or was it actually doing something else before then? So
I think they're really engaging with that short form.
Well, to give you one perspective on that, my friends at Comcast will tell me we don't care what they subscribe to as long as they pay us $120 a month. Whether it's television and or games and or who knows what. They're in the business of delivering products to the consumer, whatever they may be. Do we have any more questions? Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your time. We'll see you hopefully again, same time, same station, next year.